All right, welcome back from that short break. And of course, I'm still enjoying the interviews coming through right here on Urban Television. And this morning, we're going to be talking to a law student. Another youth is with us in studio, but this time around, we're going to be discussing the art of debate, this business of opposers, proposers, and the audience. And then you switch off the microphone, needs to come to an end. But anyway, allow me to introduce to you, she goes by the names of Naiga Shubra Kasozi. Very exotic name. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Very fantastic. Good to have you on the show.
Good to be here. It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
It's Shubra, your birth name. Or it is one of those names you lawyers get to threaten people in court.
it's a given name. It's a given name.
It's a given name.
Yes, by parents.
Interesting. How is it being, a law student, given, all these kind of cases that are coming up every day in the country?
Well, it becomes more challenging and also more entertaining, because getting to read cases in itself is something that is fun. You get to see the lacunas, what we call loopholes, in the given cases of particular lawyers, submissions from people. It's actually fun. Yeah.
Lacunas.
Lacuna.
But this has always been a lacuna on this show. But
you have just gotten to learn about that word.
No,
you're being a lacuna.
No.
But anyway, you have engaged yourself in, authoritarian kind of work, whereby you do have books that you have published for the public right there. First and foremost, let's even get into the reason as to why, despite being a law student, you have, gotten yourself into this book publishing business.
Well, I think they're totally connected, the law, publishing, and writing, because you see, the law predicates upon articulation of ideas and viewpoints. And I couldn't find any better way to articulate these ideas than writing, because writing lives on. I was a debater since my high school. I have so many achievements as a debater, but what difference does it make if I kept that to myself without having to teach anybody out there that, there is power in being able to articulate yourself, to tell people what you think, inspire others and the like. So that book right there is out to inspire young ladies and gentlemen.
I think that one of the things that people don't know about debate is that are the rules of debate. And I'm reading it on page 12 of your first book of The Art of Debate. And you're saying no research is permitted, no outside assistance is allowed, citation of sources is paramount, debaters must practice intellectual honesty, the submissions should be on team basis.
Yes.
What's intellectual honesty?
Intellectual honesty. You see, as a lawyer, or as a law student, I would be expected to act in a professional manner. Because debate in itself is an art that brings us together to discuss matters, to come to solutions. If for you, you're just out there to create frolics and lies about ideas and situations, then you're not out to create solutions for those particular problems. So it's better that you practice honesty. If the rate of if the mortality rate is actually at 5% and just you want to inflate it to a 20%, then you're not discussing the real issue. We want to look at the heart of the matter, and therefore it's better to be honest rather than lie about things.
Would you put, debate and court sessions in one bracket? Do you think these two are actually even similar in any way?
They're a little related, because we get to speak about things, but a court session is different in the sense that it predicates on the rule of law, as opposed to debate that predicates on so many things such as emotions, statistics, facts, sentiments, so many things happening around us, some of which are not related to the law.
Okay. Yes. But to look at your books, The Art of Debate, you have the first edition and then you have the second edition right here. Did you feel like the message you are trying to send in the first edition was not, yielding the kind of results you wanted, and hence having the second edition? In other words, what made you have the second edition of The Art of Debate?
All right. So for purposes of our record, the first edition was written when I was 17 years old. I wrote that book in my senior six vacation.
What were you doing when you were 17? Well,
be honest. When I was in my senior six vacation.
We didn't say senior six vacation. We said when you were
17 years of age. Yeah. Do I remember? That was a long time ago. But when I was in my senior six vacation, I think I was in some car village.
Nantunda Manda. It's okay. So you were still telling us about doing the first
one. So that edition was written when I was 17 years old. Of course, I wrote that in my capacity as a 17-year-old. I had ambition to make sure that I inspired the 16-year-olds, the 17-year-olds, and people behind me, yes. But as I get to grow, I get to appreciate debate more, because I'm still a debater. I debate at university level. There are new things to learn about debate. And I don't see why I should not tell people about them just because I have a first edition that should stay. Yes, that is why I decided to write a second edition. And you're actually the first people to see it today because I haven't launched it yet.
Mm. Is that, oh, wow. Okay. This one or the other one?
This one.
This one. Thank
okay.
you.
Yeah. Yeah. No, no.
That's my name. Thank
no,
you.
No, you don't know. You don't like debate. I like debate. There's a difference. Let's just respect
Are
each other
me?
And you give me the copy.
Am I you?
Do we know? Okay. For me, I'd like to, you know, what's the difference between argument and debate? And do you think that people, for example, in parliament, are debating, or do you think they are arguing? Because if I read from, you know, page 17, you give us what the first speaker is supposed to do, then the second speaker, then the opposer, they have sort of roles. And remember, in one of the rules, you say that, you know, it's a team-based arrangement. Do you think that in Uganda we have arguments as opposed to having debate? And what's the difference?
Now, people should be in position to understand the difference between bickering and arguing.
Mm.
Debate cannot be divorced from argument because argument is what brings out the point.
Mm.
On the other hand, bickering does not bring out the point. It just literally brings out what you feel about that particular idea.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm.
So argument is a packaged concept. It's a concept where you have a fact that you're going to state, you're going to give it evidence, and you're going to give it analysis to convince people about it. So what I expect from parliamentarians of my country is argument that has matter. Content, evidence, and analysis. You cannot have that if you do not have if you're not researched. Yeah, some people just go to parliament to talk, but what do you think is going to be the end result of that? You're not going to have an impact. You're talking about oil and gas, the extraction of oil from a particular part of the country. You don't even know the process of extraction of oil. You did not read about it. That means you have no analysis, you have no evidence. You just have bickering and argumentation. That is why, actually it's not argumentation, it's just bickering. And that is why you find that people in parliament end up beating each other, blows.
Yeah,
so
because they fail to bring the argument on the table. So
yes.
Then do you think that we need to, you know, have people like you who have grown in this debate business for a while, you know, helping our politicians who come up with these laws that affect us, to, you know, have, you know, a better country?
I think that's a brilliant idea. These people need to understand why they're in parliament. Participatory democracy predicates upon representation of the people. You cannot represent people if you cannot articulate issues. If you articulate blows, at the end of the day people are going to get blows. But if you articulate
but the
ideas,
blows came up as a result of articulating issues. I mean, We all know that story and how it all happened in 2017.
That's a problem of packaging.
Mm.
You see, you cannot articulate without being able to package your stuff properly.
Mm.
How do you articulate?
They're human beings at the end of the day, and they got emotional, and emotional, you know, led into the blows. So what exactly would you be saying as far as, you know, the articulation levels are concerned?
If I may also take you back to the fact that these people are voted into power by Ugandans. By the time I give my vote to you, you're supposed to be sui generis, somebody who's special. You understand? If you are a leader, you should be in position to contain your emotions because there's a purpose at the end of the day. What message does it send out there if, as a young person, 15 years old, I'm seated on TV, I want to be an MP, and I'm seeing my MP throwing blows? Did I send the MP to throw blows, or rather to send ideas that are going to help the nation? Yes?
For example, if it's me, Derek, Farouk, and Francis, and we have a, you know, we're a team and we're headed for a debate, am I allowed to, if Derek wanted to say something, and then I say, no, you're not going to say something, let Francis say it, is that allowed in debate? Because at the end of the day, we want to win the argument, so I say, no, Derek, you won't bring it up properly, Francis, do the job.
Now, this is the thing. Debate creates what we call collective responsibility. But you see, for collective responsibility to come through, everyone should be able to participate in a particular venture. At the end of the day, I'll be accountable for what I will have said. That is why we have the first proposer, second proposer, and third proposer. They each have a particular role they play to have a collective end or bargain that is going to be preached to the audience and the other parties. So the first speaker will come in to discuss what the debate is about and give it a particular direction. The second speaker is going to come and build from that foundation to actually articulate that particular idea. You see, that creates teamwork. That is why you find that debaters will not be people who are going to be throwing blows. They will not throw blows because they know how to work together. They also know how to compromise to reach a particular...
I think that's why, and I hate to just take it political, but that's where it is right now.
I mean, it's
but
not
when you look
basically.
At, yeah, because I watch
you
a lot of
run away from it.
Parliament sessions here, and I'm looking at how these guys are playing their game, and I feel like the ruling party always has, you know, better quality information, and you know, how they play their game is always better than the opposition, because the opposition is I want to say something, and he stands up and says something, and then Katol Wama brings in his funny things.
Maybe they're not informed enough. I don't know.
Do you think that's the problem the opposition is facing on the floor of parliament, that they are not good debaters at all?
I think the problem now is failure to understand their mandate. All of them. Their mandate is to represent the people, not to represent their political parties. So they are too partisan. They are failing to be objective. You understand? Sometimes you may compromise and agree with the government if it's something that is sensible that they are doing. If it is not sensible, then come down to tell them about it, that there's a problem here. You don't exactly have to fight over it.
Do you think they would actually agree with you on that? Because if I could take you back to a couple of instances that did happen, especially when the OTT, you know, came through, you know, we saw people get on the streets and they're saying, our people cannot afford this tax here. We are speaking on behalf of the people. And then you bringing up this idea whereby, you know, they're forefronting their parties instead of the ideas of the people. Do you think they would agree with you on that?
Now, speaking about the strikes and people going out to the streets and talking about it, I think they were practicing their constitutional right to express themselves. That is fine. They can go ahead and do that. But again, fundamentally, they have representatives. So if the representatives don't do their job of telling the government what they're supposed to do, then they are failing at the end of the day. They become ordinary men, because if a Shubra ordinarily, I can go to the streets and say, hey, I do not want to pay the OTT. I do not want to pay the OTT. I'm expressing my sentiment from my own particular point of view. But you see, the whole idea behind parliament is that it's there to make laws for the good governance of the country, implying that we're looking at the greater good. The greater good sometimes may not be the good of a particular individual. As Shubra may not be able to afford OTT, but is there a good that is going to be gained, a greater good going to be got from the OTT? If it is there, then let's talk about that particular material instead of talking about non-material things that can be articulated by just anybody. You're supposed to be a special person at the end of the day.
If I could come back to your second edition of The Art of Debate, something that you wrote, you say that The Art of Debate was written purposely to impact on high school students, some of whom struggle with articulating their ideas well, others do not even know their capabilities. Therefore, it is intended to arouse interest in young people to express themselves and speak out on issues that are close to their hearts. It further teaches them how to debate by delivering into different technicalities of competitive debates. Do you think that debates in schools have actually lived up to this kind of exposure?
Now, of course, that is going to have to be relative. Debate has done a very good job, it's of great significance in high schools because of the fact that now people get to know that, hey, I can talk about the constitution of Uganda without necessarily being a lawyer. If you've watched debates on TV nowadays, they're on everywhere. You hear students say, Article 1 of the Constitution says that the power belongs to the people, by the people, and for the people, who shall exercise their power through, you know, you understand? If young people at the ages of 11, 12, 13 can talk about such things, by the time they are 20 years old, they will understand that power does lie in their hands. But how are they going to exercise their power? It's going to be through voting, not through shouting. But because at the end of the day, we have procedure, because procedure governs us. A lawless society is not what we desire. We desire a society that has the rule of law.
I've just forgotten the word. I wanted to use a big word to ask you why you lawyers and debaters use big words. Is that a technique? Is that a trick you do all the time? And someone says, instead of saying this was too painful, they say this was too excruciating. Like, that's huge. Is it a trick you guys do to use big words on the floor?
What can I say? Big is relative. For some people, the word
now you're abusing me. Now you're abusing me.
Now she's being a typical lawyer.
The word excruciating in itself may sound simple to somebody, and then it sounds so hard to another person. So I don't think the intention is to actually confuse people. The intention is to talk and speak. If that's what I know in my grammar, then that's how I'll say it.
I think our MP, what is his name? This guy who usually uses those hard words.
Mbidu. Mukasa Mbidu.
I think he would beg to differ. Sometimes he just uses those words to confuse the public. But anyway, as we do get to wrap up with this particular one, The Art of Debate, where can someone get a copy of these books?
Yes, the books can be got from Aristock. You can acquire a copy through Aristock or on Kindle, Amazon Kindle.
Okay.
Yes, you can get a paper line edition or you can get just an online one.
Shubra, who do you want to be remembered as? Because now you're getting yourself involved in law. You're definitely going to be a very brilliant lawyer, maybe even a judge. You're getting yourself involved into publishing work. I don't know what else do you do. There's a lot of things on your plate right about now from what I see. But who do you want to be remembered as?
Well, my passion is in advocacy. I want to advocate for the right thing. And what is so dear to my heart always is the idea that women are supposed to be supported in so many ways. Because whether people want to believe it or not, women are in a very tight spot in so many places of this country. Okay. I want to be that person who's going to uplift in as many women and young people as possible through my inspiration, through my writings, through my advocacy skills as a lawyer. I want to be able to be that change that comes along to those particular women.
Now that you're a woman and I'm a man and I disagree with you, that's something we shall debate on for a very long time.
The way you started that statement. But anyway, now that we are with a lawyer, and of course she's going to be advocating for a couple of things, maybe she could help us advocate with a couple of advice coming in our love letter. I hope you do not mind that.
Oh.
Are you the lovey-dovey person or?
Not exactly, but we can be objective about it. Let's hear it.
And objectivity is relative, isn't it? But anyway, in case you're watching, we'll be diving into our love letter this particular morning. And of course, one is writing to us saying that my boyfriend, whom I dated for 10 years, died 3 weeks ago in a fatal accident. I was devastated, but I met someone who was always there for me. We have had a good time. And last week, he asked me to be his girlfriend, saying he loves me. I have also fallen for him, but I am worried of moving on since people will start judging me. What should I do? That is going to be the love letter that we'll be diving into. And of course, studio lines are going to be open immediately after this break.